Station. This is Houston. Are you ready for the event?
Houston, we're ready for the event.
From the Front Range to the International Space Station, his business card reads astronaut, NASA flight engineer, colonel, and Air Force Academy grad. And we're so happy to welcome Colorado native Jack Fischer to Colorado's Morning News. Good morning.
Good morning. How you doing?
Oh, I'm absolutely fabulous. How exciting to get to go live to the ISS. I know you're a big fan of your hometown radio station. Are you getting withdrawals from being up there and not being able to hear us?
Absolutely. You know, when I was growing up, we used to turn down the television so that Dad could watch the Bronco game and listen to the KOA announcers. So we've been KOA fans for a long time.
Awesome. Well, you've been up there at the International Space Station since April. How has it been? And tell me about those first few hours, the first time you've been in space, what you're thinking about. Are you pinching yourself?
Oh, absolutely. You know, this is a radio interview, but I'm hanging from the ceiling like a crazy space bat because I can, and it's so much fun. The first few hours, actually the first few minutes, after about 8 minutes, I was already in orbit, and looking out the window, you see this thin, frail blue line that holds all the life we know of, and it was just amazing. It was a perspective change, and some of the views and the fun that you have up here, and the sense that you're actually contributing and making a difference is phenomenal. I absolutely love it.
What's kind of your day-to-day routine? What do you do up there at the International Space Station?
Well, we keep pretty darn busy. We get up about 6 a.m. We have to do about 2.5 hours of working out a day in order to maintain our muscles and bone mass so we don't come back to Earth looking like a 90-year-old man. We also then, from about 7 in the morning till 7 at night, we're working science. So that's our main goal, and the main purpose of this wonderful floating laboratory is to work. We'll be working about 300 experiments over the 5 to 6 month increment. So it's a fantastic amount of science. Really looking forward to see what discoveries we can make. And then obviously we have to upkeep the station, keep the systems running, and you know, eat and sleep and all of those wonderful things.
I want to talk about what you eat, but back to the experiments quickly. Anything from CU Boulder?
Oh, my gosh, yeah. There's a gal that we work with almost daily, Shankini, that's at CU Boulder. And one of my favorite experiments that Peggy was working on yesterday and the day before is we found that we can grow not only grow cancerous lung tissue in space a lot more rapidly, but then we're also testing a drug, and it's kind of like a targeted drug. I call it a cancer-seeking missile. You can't take the fighter pilot out of the astronaut. And it's been doing great, so we're really excited about that. My daughter has had her own battle with cancer, and so it touches close to home, and we're really excited about the thought that we could have such a big impact on such a horrible disease.
I read that you have two daughters, and your wife is actually from Boulder, so very cool. Let me ask you about the food you're eating. We've all seen The Martian with Matt Damon. Are you eating MREs? Do you have anything exciting like ice cream? What's the weirdest thing you've eaten up there in space?
Well, if you ask Peggy, she'll say pretty much everything. I put hot sauce or ranch dressing on a lot of stuff. But, yeah, most of our food is like an MRE in those packages, or it's freeze-dried and dehydrated, and then we can rehydrate it with water. But you can be creative. There's a bunch of sauces and things, and, you know, it's not so bad. And when a vehicle like SpaceX comes up that has a refrigerator in it, they'll send us a little treat, like a little ice cream bar, and we really love those.
Oh, that's awesome. By the way, if you're just tuning in, you're wondering, who the heck is she talking to? That's astronaut Jack Fischer. He's from Louisville, Colorado. He is up in space right now at the International Space Station. I believe we're simulcasting with NASA TV. Jack, every astronaut has a different take on what the Earth looks like from space. How would you describe it?
You know, it's got so many different moods. You can see things that are just incredibly beautiful. You can see things that are scary, like a hurricane or a cyclone. I took a picture the other day. I'll try to post it with the sunset and the oranges and blues, Bronco colors, are amazing. You know, it's just, it takes your breath away almost every time you look out the window, whether it's day or night. It's just awe-inspiring.
Yeah, to see a sunrise or sunset up there must just look amazing. Does it make you realize how small and fragile the planet is?
Oh, my gosh, yeah. Like I told you, you know, right after I got to orbit and I see this little thin blue line, and everything we know is in that little thin blue line over this huge planet. So you really see the frailty of what we have and how special it is. But we also look outward, and we're just amazed by the number of stars and galaxies and just the expanse of space. And everybody who's an astronaut, anybody who's working at NASA is really excited about the possibility of exploring further and finding out what else is out there.
Jack, are you back by the holidays? When are you coming back down?
Well, it depends. You know, space flight isn't an exact science as far as when we come up and down. I should be coming home around September. Might be as late as November. It'll just depend on the schedule and when the rockets come out and get ready.
Oh, I thought you almost said the Rockies. Have you been following how well the Colorado Rockies are doing?
Man, you know, I went to the Academy in 95 when the Rockies came, and if you cut me, I'll bleed orange and blue. I'm a Broncos fan like a crazy person, but I can't claim that I'm a baseball fan because they kind of came after I was already gone and in the military.
All right. Well, it's so fun to be a Rockies fan right now while they're winning 58-43, I think, their record right now. Jack Fischer, what a pleasure to get to talk with you. This is certainly the highlight of our day. I have a feeling it's probably not the highlight of yours. You got a lot more important fish to fry, but thank you so much for joining us live from the International Space Station.
Well, thanks for having me and talking to me, and hello to everybody, all my family and friends in Colorado, and love KOA. See you next time.
Station, this is Houston ACR. That concludes the KOA portion of the event. Please stand by for a voice check from KFI Radio.
Station, this is Trevor Gertis with KFI Radio. How do you hear me?
Hear you loud and clear. How do you hear me?
I hear you great. Nice to talk to you. So let's see here.
That's fantastic to talk to you as well.
Well, thank you very much. I just wanted to set the stage because this is obviously a radio interview. So for those listening, what does it look like from where you're sitting or standing or floating above the Earth?
Well, right now I'm in the U.S. laboratory. I'm actually hanging from the ceiling just because I thought that would be fun, even though it's a radio interview. It's still fun. This is kind of the heart and soul of the U.S. segment of the space station. It has some of the primary systems as well as some of our larger experiment racks. We only have one window in here that's actually occupied by an experiment, so I can't see outside from here. But it's still super fun because you get to float and work on science. How cool is that?
Well, yeah, floating, I think, is pretty much everyone's dream and for life. I think that just sounds amazing. So I was wondering, you're up there working, staying in shape, doing all the scientific research. How much time do you actually have to sit and look out the window and take photos?
You know, we have a bit of time. Every now and again, we'll get some free time on the weekend or at night, you know, after our main activities are done. So we get some time, and it's time well spent to go sit in the cupola or down to the Russian segment. They have some really high-quality windows where we can take pictures just to go and just soak up and get all pruny in the beautiful views that we have of our precious Earth.
And when you look down, is it easy to tell what part of the Earth you're looking at? Can you say, like, oh, look, there's, I feel like I'm right above Colorado. There's my family down there.
Well, I'm getting smarter. Somebody like Fyodor Yurchikhin, our commander now, who's been up here, this is his fifth space flight. He can tell you where we are anytime by looking out this window for 5 seconds. It's amazing. And he's teaching me how to find all the places and, okay, to find the pyramids, you go here and here. And, you know, I'm learning, but it's a slow process because you see stuff in such a different, wildly different and beautiful perspective that you're not used to, that sometimes it really throws your brain for a loop and you just want to sit there with your mouth open and enjoy the beauty as opposed to figuring out exactly where you are.
That sounds really amazing. And obviously that's what everyone dreams about when they think about being an astronaut. And I actually was wondering how your dream of becoming an astronaut started, because, you know, when you look up your bio, you have a very extensive military experience, lots of time in the military, flying all sorts of aircraft, serving overseas. How did you make that transition to studying to become an astronaut?
Well, you know, I always wanted to be an astronaut, but I also wanted to serve my country. So it was the perfect blend. And, you know, I went to the Air Force Academy, and then I wanted that every step along the way, I would love what I was doing. And I love being a fighter pilot. I love being a test pilot. I love being an astronaut. You know, if the astronaut thing, which is sometimes more luck than anything else to get here, didn't work out, I was happy as a clam serving my country and flying cool airplanes. So, and just up the road from you, my kind of second home is Edwards Air Force Base, which you can see really easily from space.
Really? Well, it's pretty big.
Well, those big old lake beds are pretty easy to spot.
And I also noticed you had to wait quite some time to actually get to space. You were chosen for the program, I think it was 2009. You started your training a little bit later. And did you ever, I mean, get tired of waiting around and say, I want to get to space already?
Oh, you bet. Absolutely. I'd love to say I'm a patient man, but that would be a horrible lie. We signed up for the program right when shuttle was dying off. So, the number of slots and opportunities to fly in space were drastically reduced. Right now, we're kind of sitting at this launch point where commercial providers and more opportunities on the space station, as well as further deep space exploration, are giving us more opportunities to go into space. So I think our class and the following two classes are going to be able to fly maybe a bit sooner than I did.
And do you like to think that maybe someday you could get to venture further out in space, or do you think Earth orbits about as far as you're going to get as an astronaut?
You know, I'd love to, absolutely would love to, but I also feel that it's important to take all the experiences that you're given, treat them as a gift, and give back what you can with those experiences. So, you know, we're looking 10, 15 years down the road. I think maybe I might be a little old at that point, but I can certainly do everything in my power to take this opportunity that I was given and, you know, spread the gospel of spaceflight and try to make it so that these following classes can make it there. Because most important to me is to make a difference and to get humanity that permanent foothold in space, which I think we're about to do. So I'll do everything I can to help with that.
Yeah, sure. So I was also imagining, anyone imagines going into space, I think a high point that we think about, like to picture ourselves doing, is spacewalking, EVAs. And your first spacewalk was not too long ago, just a few months, I think. Was it everything you dreamed it would be? Did it feel different than you imagined?
Oh, it was so much more than I thought it would be, because I couldn't imagine that cool. It was, you know, you look out the window and it's just awe-inspiring how beautiful things are. But then to go out and be all immersed in it is just a completely different level. orders of magnitude cooler. The first one, I went out and there was day and night passes. You know, every 90 minutes we go around the Earth. And so the day you're looking down and, oh, my gosh, it's so beautiful. The Earth is just cruising by you. And then you look up and there's more stars and galaxies than I could even imagine. It was just mind-boggling. And then the second one, we were in daylight the entire time because of our position over the Earth. And just seeing the sunset, sunrise kind of beauty all the time during that EVA was just amazing. And I come from a construction family, so, you know, being out there and working with my hands is just something that really gets me going.
And then another aspect of the astronaut experience that I think we forget about sometimes is you actually get a lot of attention from pretty high-level people. I mean, I was seeing, of course, you got a phone call from the president not too long ago. I saw Garth Brooks called up to sing to you guys. I don't know if there's any others that you'd like to mention, but I was also curious, do you have maybe like a wish of a celebrity that you would love to get a phone call from?
Well, I think Garth would have been pretty darn high on that list. The River's my favorite song, and he's my favorite artist, so that was a dream for me. Obviously, what an incredible honor to be able to talk to the president about space, and that was shortly after Peggy had surpassed the U.S. record for the most days in space of any U.S. astronaut, which was, you know, a huge milestone. So, you know, you're up here, and it's not a you can't think of it as, oh my gosh, it's this personal thing. It's not. We're the face of this massive organization and massive team the world over, multiple control centers and thousands of people that make this place possible. So we're trying to do our best to represent all of those people and that team to whoever calls. And, you know, explain what an incredible laboratory and what incredible science we're doing up here to change humanity for the better.
Well, thank you so much. That's all the time I think we have. But it's been such a privilege to talk to you, astronaut Jack Fischer and Colonel in the U.S. Air Force. Thanks so much for taking the time to talk while you're floating up there, and keep waving down here to Earth for us.
You bet I will. You guys have a great day.
Station, this is Houston ACR. That concludes the event.
Thank you, KOA Radio and KFI Radio. Station, we are now resuming operational audio communications.